Lufia and the Fortress of Doom is a game I played once for about an hour 20 years ago. This is another of those Super Nintendo games I got introduced to through having SNES 9X on our original Xbox. Despite not getting very far, I always intended to go back to it eventually, and by the time I started doing this channel, I always had this in the back of my mind as a possible game to cover. I am using an emulator to play this game, as it was never released in PAL territories, it has never been re-released as of the writing of this video, and I ain't paying eBay prices for a US copy. So my goal for this save is to acquire every item in the game, and the game keeps track and lets you know at the end, and raise all of my party members to level 99. On starting a new game, I have to name the protagonist. As I have said many times before, I hate coming up with names, and this guy has no canon name. We'll get to what I chose in a bit. Before the title screen and after naming the main character, we get an introduction about the time an island suddenly appeared in the sky 100 years ago. It would be ruled by four powerful evil beings known as the Sinistrals. Each one represented the powers of chaos, terror, destruction and death. Those last two are a little close for my liking, and whoever chose theirs first is right to accuse the other of ripping them off. Some of the strongest warriors in the world couldn't deal with the Sinistrals until four appeared who took the fight to them. Maxim, Selan, Arteia and Guy. The four warriors can't see in this place, and so Selan has to use magic to brighten it up. That's Maxim with the red hair, Selan the girl with light blue, Arteia with dark blue, and Guy the blonde. The Fortress of Doom is freezing and suffocating with dark energy as the heroes are welcomed by the leader of the Sinistrals, Dais. Maxim demands he show himself, but Dais and the other Sinistrals are waiting above for them. I then gain control. This dungeon, along with starting me off with a team of seasoned warriors, teaches you how to get used to the game. The route forward is straight ahead, but off to the west is a room with a chest inside. It has a power potion, an item that increases your maximum HP. Considering my party are in their level 70s, it's not that essential. Down the stairs here into the basement, to the east I get my first battle against a Mad Wolf and Megatoad. The battle system is quite basic. You have your normal attacks, magic, items and defend. It all works fine, but I do have one large criticism in that this game is still clinging to that decision from the 8-bit days, where party members don't auto-target a new enemy if the one they're already aiming at is killed. So it's easy to have a lot of wasted turns. I have seen some people who don't mind this or even like it for making you have to plan out your attacks more. I just find it irritating and a time waster. I can go north into the centre of the room, taking on my first rock golems on the way, who get Maxim to level 79 and Selan to level 78. Through that door are three chests. Mind potion to increase intelligence for stronger spells, speed potion to increase agility, and great potion to increase strength. Then to the opposite side of the basement I entered from and up the stairs for a battle against a pair of Hydra. My party is so powerful for this intro that they annihilate everything. Guy reaches level 78 and Arteia reaches level 76. The chest contains a spell potion which increases maximum MP. Out the door to end up back in the starting room, fighting my first Efreet, which looks even more threatening right next to the goofy Hydra. I run north up the centre of the room to reach the stairs going up. This is a walk straight north, but with a side area off to the east, which I face some mad knights on the way to. The little side room has a chest containing another power potion. Back on track north to the next room, which I then have to follow to the east before I go south into a mirrored version of the previous room. This time the side room is off to the west and has a chest with a spell potion inside. All the way south in this room is the stairs going up to the next floor. Now this next floor is a straight line north up some steps to the next staircase. But if I walk all the way around them to the north end of this room, there's a pair of chests. The first has a miracle, the equivalent to a Final Fantasy elixir, full HP and MP restore. The other is a second miracle. Back to the south end of the room, there are two sets of steps to climb. If I took only the first set and went around to the north end again, I can reach stairs to a screen where I can get a free heal, but I don't need it. I just keep moving north, past these four statues and up the stairs. North through the door, and to keep going, I just need to go north. But there are three chests to be found if I circle the outside of this pit in the middle. A miracle from the east chest, a miracle from the north chest, and a miracle from the west chest. And that's all the treasures to be found in the Fortress of Doom. I now try to cross this bridge in the middle of the room. Dais says I may cross, but Selan worries it could be a trap. Maxim shrugs off that concern, and when Selan tries to explain, Maxim tells him that Dais is testing them and they aren't to show any fear. Guy is the first to cross, then Arteia, saying he is powered by the hopes of his people. Maxim talks Selan into it by saying that they can still win as long as the dual blade he wields still has its light. He says it makes them all more powerful and assures her that they'll destroy the Sinistrals and restore peace to the world. The two cross and Dais is impressed, Selan telling the Sinistrals she's going to kill the shit out of them. Dais can sense a strange energy from Selim which he realises must be the human emotion love, which he has no comprehension of. It isn't spelled out fully at first, but Maxim and Selim are married and have a child at home. Through the teleporter to reach the top and to the north to meet the Sinistrals face to face. Maxim and Dais throw a few threats around, but Dais will have to wait as Gaddis wants to go first. Now to do something other than attack with everyone. Maxim and Guy still attack, while I have Selan cast Thunder, a very strong spell, while Arteia casts Trick, which increases the target's agility so that they get more turns in before Gaddis can next act. Arteia also has the party healing spell Valor for when HP gets low. He's got hundreds of MP so I don't have to worry about running out. It's not long before Gaddis is defeated. We take a step forward and next in line is Amon. This time I have Selan and Arteia cast Mirror on the party, which will reflect enemy spells. Amon likes to cast the Flood and Sunder spells, which target the entire party. Which means for every party member that has Mirror, he gets an individual hit from his own reflected flood. Although he takes far less damage from it than my party do. So as long as I maintain the Mirror effect on everyone, Amon is probably the easiest of the Sinistrals and is destroyed in no time. Arteia reaches level 77 from his defeat. Only two Sinistrals remain and the only one between me and Dais is Erim. I use the same strategy I used for Amon, keeping up Mirror on the party. Not because Erim liked whole party spells, but because she uses powerful single target spells like Thunder, and not taking any damage from that is a big help. She too is defeated, getting Maxim to level 80 and Guy to level 79. Only Dais remains, who praises the party's skills before the final battle starts. Once again I have to start with Mirror. Dais has access to the multi-fire target spell Vulcan, which is especially devastating to Guy. It's strong enough that it even does decent damage to Dais himself when reflected. Not that it matters too much, as a single cast of Valor undoes all that damage. The Mirror strategy works as well as it did before and Dais falls, getting Selan to level 79, for all the good that's going to do for her. With the Sinistrals cornered, they still have one last trick left. They surround the party and try to gather all of their energies together for one massive spell. A spell that, if allowed to reach its full potential, could devastate the entire world. Maxim tries to interrupt it, but he needs the combined energies of the other three too. Selan says that it's too dangerous, but Maxim tells them they need to do it now. They give it a try, but the Sinistrals are still more powerful. Maxim pushes them to try harder, while Arteia warns him that Selan is running out of energy and can't take much more. Selan brushes Arteia's concerns aside and the party begin to overwhelm the Sinistrals. They unleash the energy, destroying all the Sinistrals at once and sending everyone but Maxim flying around. Maxim checks on the others. Guy is alright, as is Arteia, but Selan's not doing so good, yet focusing more on the fact that they've saved the world. That spell wrecked her body, and despite having been speaking all of this, she claims that she can't anymore. She wishes that she could have been able to live in the new peaceful world she helped create and raise her child. That's when the bridge collapses and Guy and Arteia are separated from Maxim and Selan. Guy says the fortress is collapsing, and Arteia needs to cast the warp spell, but Maxim and Selan are out of his range. Maxim has to tell the two of them to save themselves. They need to let everyone know that the Sinistrals are dead. Even with Selan gone, Maxim doesn't want to leave her alone. Guy has to convince Arteia that there's nothing they can do now, and Arteia says his goodbyes before he and Guy warp out. Like Selan, Maxim wishes he got to experience the new world he leaves behind. This is why I always remembered this game from the little I played. It was the first time I'd seen a game do this, start on a final battle, give you that taste of power, and then open the game on a downer. And after having played the entire game, I still think this prologue is its most memorable part, so I'm not surprised that the second game is a prequel starring Maxim's party. Doom Island fell into the sea, taking Maxim with it, the events becoming known as the Battle of Doom Island in history. 90 years later, the world is still at peace as the Battle of Doom Island passes from living memory, but it can't last forever. We open on the town Alekia, where nothing is happening. That is when our main character, a descendant of Maxim, comes running in. I've seen some just name him Maxim after his ancestor, but to avoid confusion whenever Maxim is brought up, in my desperation for an idea, I decided to make his name Maxim spelled backwards. However, I forgot that that only swaps two letters in the name, and so our protagonist is named Mixam. He visits Roman, the owner of the inn. Even as young as he is, he makes a habit of adventuring into caves alone. While they talk, a young girl with blue hair comes in. Roman asks if she's alone and she doesn't answer. He can tell that she's new to town, so he asks her name. She doesn't answer still. But when Mixam introduces himself and asks, she tells him that her name is Lufia. He asks where her parents are. No answer. He asks where she lives and she responds by asking him to play with her. Mixam is confused by that answer, but Lufia insists on playing tag and the two run off as Roman wonders who Lufia is. 9 years later, Mixam is now one of Alekia's knights and reports to his fellow knights for afternoon training. But it seems his fellow knights have become complacent with the lack of monster attacks and decide a better use of their time is to watch their colleague Jack harass a woman named Uria for a laugh, which seems to be a regular occurrence. Mixam is frustrated and storms off in the other direction. Another knight tells Mixam to relax, saying that it's peacetime and they should be allowed to kick back and slack off. But Mixam is always thinking about the next possible monster attack. He's told there hasn't been any monsters for 100 years, so he's worrying about nothing. He storms off again, stopping when he reaches the flower field where Lufia is. When Mixam says why he isn't training, Lufia says that the commander won't be happy about it. Once he makes it clear that practice was cancelled because of everyone but him, he asks what she's doing. Lufia found some prithia buds and runs off to show him, Mixam not being able to tell the difference between them and other flowers. Lufia runs all over while Mixam struggles to keep an eye on her. She says that they're an incredibly rare flower that look very pretty when they bloom. Mixam teases her for having always been into flowers, to which Lufia remembers how she used to make him wreaths when they were kids. The two reminisce about how happy life was back then. Mixam then asks Lufia how she feels about life in its current state. She's pretty fine with it. There's peace and she gets to spend life with Mixam. But all Mixam can think about is how bad things were 100 years ago and how long the current peacetime will last. He worries what would happen if the Sinistrals came back without Maxim to fight them off again. Lufia tells him that he's a knight and he shares Maxim's blood, so that should be enough. Lufia decides they should head home and offers to make him some cinnamon tea, which Mixam says is one of her few recipes that's actually good. This winds up Lufia, who points out that it's very popular with the guests at the inn. Mixam accuses her of using magic herbs that change the taste of things instead of making it properly, pissing Lufia off even more and leading to her threatening to never let him drink it before it's her turn to storm off. Mixam calms her down, saying he was only joking, and asks if she'll also make him her cinnamon pie, which he says is the best in the world. That ends up working on her. They head to the inn and Lufia tells Roman she's taking over the oven to make many, many cinnamon pies. When Roman asks what Mixam did to get her in such a good mood and Mixam tells him, Roman points out that he can never get Lufia to do any baking for him. Mixam can't believe it. Since Roman took Lufia in, he thinks the least she can do is bake him a pie. As they think about how it's been 9 years since then, Mixam overhears two customers talking about how the nearby kingdom Sheran has been attacked by monsters. The other guy finds it hard to believe, thinking the knights would have looked into it by now. But Sheran won't let the Alekian knights enter, so they'd have no way of knowing. And they're lazy. And so Mixam runs off without telling Lufia, ending up in her bad books again. For whatever reason, Roman doesn't actually tell her what's going on and leaves her to get pissed off. And this is where I gain control. First person I talk to is a kid who really knows how to lay the guilt on for making Lufia cry. The next person lets us know that her and Mixam have always been inseparable. Another says that Mixam should take Lufia to the town Lorbenia, which has all the newest popular dresses on sale. Lorbenia's on a different continent, how's he supposed to squeeze that in? Even the people in the inn who prompted Mixam to run out call him a dipshit for running out on Lufia. I can go upstairs in the inn and take one of Lufia's dresses from a wardrobe. I'm sure this will get her to stop being mad at him. I then take said dress to the shops behind the inn and sell it for 60 gold. This may sound like an awful thing to do to your sort of girlfriend but not yet, but look at it from my point of view. I needed to steal it for the 100%. I have limited inventory space and that dress doesn't give very good defense anyway. I also buy a dagger for 50 gold. It's a 6-point attack upgrade over the knife Mixam starts with. Also, apparently he only wears a single sandal. The cupboard next to the item shopkeeper is hiding a potion. West of the inn is a church, which is where I can save the game, revive KO'd party members, and remove curses like in a Dragon Quest. But next to the priest, I can see a chest and some stairs that lead to it. To the west, an old man tells me that to get to Sheran, I need to go through a cave to the north. The next house on the west is hiding a revive in a cupboard. It also has some stairs leading to an underground passage that take me to the back of the church so I can open the chest for a sweet water, an item that reduces the encounter rate. The reason this path exists is because the priest hates rain and wants to avoid the risk of getting caught in it. Returning to the guardhouse in the northwest of town, one of the soldiers says I should check with the commander before rushing off to Sheran. I find a cloth helm in the cupboard here. That seems like a pretty bad material to make a helmet out of, but it is to a defense and Mixam has nothing else to cover his head with. In front of the entrance to Alekia's castle, a soldier says that the commander should be sleeping in the back room. So I go north to the castle. The first guy I find in the castle is that Jack guy who creeps over Uria. In the northwest room on the ground floor is a chest containing an arrow, a weak damaging item. The commander is here, who is hearing of the monsters attacking Sheran for the first time. Mixam wants to take a squad to check it out, but the commander can't spare that many soldiers over a rumour. In the middle back room there's an escape on a bookshelf which teleports you out of dungeons. another hides a swing wing, which will warp me to any previously visited town. The woman in this room is Yuria, hiding from Jack. This is non-recurring behaviour, but still no one has dealt with Jack yet. And you can't help her, she's stuck there hiding for the entire game. I take the stairs up to the second floor. Into the bedroom in the northwest to steal a portion from the drawers. In the middle north room for another portion on a bookshelf. Up more stairs to find the third floor. The princess, Esteia, is well aware of the rumours about Sheran and is worried for them. But she has no authority over the knights, so Mixum reassures her that he's going over there to check it out himself. She's grateful enough to give Mixum 100 gold to get started with. In the west is the princess's bedroom. I'm asked to leave, but first I steal a stuffed bear from the drawers, which I can use in battle to confuse an enemy. Also a bracelet from a bookshelf. In the northeast corner of the floor is a series of stairs going back to the first floor where I can find 3 more chests. Sweetwater, Antidote, and Revive. Back to the third floor, I can enter the throne room and talk to the king, who also refuses to send out any knights until Mixum has a look first. Back into town and I leave through the south. Onto the world map. I get heading north, getting my first proper fight after a few steps with a pair of big newts. It can be pretty painful going from maximum crew's 200 plus damage from a normal attack to a very low double or even single digit damage in the present day. Not far from Alekia to the north is a small village on the way to the cave, Chatam. The rumours of Sheran have also reached this place, but then again it is closer to Sheran than Alekia. Inspecting the tree southwest of the fields has me find a mind potion. There's also a great potion in the western field. Rather than save them, I use them both to boost Mixam's stats. A couple people are worried about those they know in Sheran, the names Lila and Daniel are mentioned. The bookshelf in the northeastern house hides a smoke ball which causes an instant flee from a random encounter. That's about everything in here, so I go outside, and before I continue moving north, I return to Alekia for a bit of levelling. I hang outside Alekia because Roman lets me stay at the inn for free, whereas at Chatham I have to pay 5 gold. I face my first mad shroom, an enemy that can actually survive one hit from me right now. That fight gets Mixam to level 2. I get going north again, fighting an alleged jellyfish on the way. North of Chatham are 2 cave entrances. I want the one on the west for plot reasons, but take the eastern one first. A simple walk west to a door leading to 2 chests, 200 gold and a potion. The rest of the cave is blocked by rocks. On the way out, Mixam reaches level 3. Now for the western cave entrance. So you know how in the previous game I covered Ease, I complained that I couldn't find any maps to easily explain my routes with? Well, huge thanks to the people at VG Maps and the one who ripped them, Flying Armor, because they have all of this game's maps uploaded, making my job a lot easier. I did cover up what the items are to keep some sort of surprise. The chests marked 2 and 3 are the ones I already opened. I start on the stairs in the centre west. To start with, I go all the way north and through this door to the northern room where I can go all the way west to find a hidden item against a rock. Then I return to where I started and go northwest, up the ladder and to the stairs leading out near Sheran. I face my first spider in here, and these are the most annoying enemy this early on, since their bite attack has a good chance of poisoning you. It also brings up another issue with the battle system. When there's a group of more than one of the same enemy, you can only target that group, not individuals, making which one you hit random. A bit irritating when you have an enemy that can poison you and takes 2 hits to kill and your character decides to spread the damage out instead of just killing one of them first to lower the risk. I do get poisoned, so it's a good thing I found that antidote earlier. The item hidden in the rock is a revive. Near the exit to Sheran I end up poisoned again at low HP. These spiders are real assholes. I just have to deal with the poison as I leave the cave and end up right outside Sheran. Thankfully, poison does not deal damage when walking inside towns. Sheran has indeed been attacked, the first dying citizen I see telling me to hurry back to Alekia. The dying innkeeper tells me that they're still here, and the priest tells me to go help any others before he dies standing up with his eyes wide open. The item shopkeeper says that the leader wore a black cape before he dies too. One tells me to hurry up and inform the king of Alekia before the same thing happens to them. I keep going north and into the castle. Through the front door and I go west to start looting the place. Look, they're all dead anyway. I'm sure they'd all want me to achieve my 100%. 4 chests here, all 4 of them potions. Then to the east for a room with another 4 chests. Awaken, Foul Water in case you want to actually increase this game's insane encounter rate, Antidote, thankfully, and Sweetwater. Then it's up the stairs to the second floor. The dying person here tells me to hurry home. I instead go west to raid the shelves. A Foul Water and a Sweet Water. To the east, a 3 chests containing 2 arrows and a stronger mid arrow, with the drawers holding a revive. Up more stairs to the third floor. I go to the room in the northeast corner for a series of stairs going down to the first floor. There's a tile here that's a different colour than the others, but I can't do anything with it just yet. So back up to the third floor to enter the throne room. It's empty, except for a chest in the northeast that has a locked door in the way. Nothing else I can do here other than leave and head back home. The journey home is uneventful, except for a big newt I kill dropping a grilled newt item, a very weak healing item that just clogs up my inventory. Back in Alekia, Mixam tells Roman about the monsters and then asks if Lufia is back yet. She is, but she's locked herself in her room, Roman telling Mixam that he should try to cheer her up. I go upstairs and Lufia is still furious, and Mixam tries to explain that he had to check out Sheran, to which she says that he could have at least waited and had some pie, but Mixam says she can always make pie. She does not take well to the implication that the massacre at Sheran is less important than her cinnamon pies. Mixam says that is ridiculous, and she tells him to leave her alone. I can get why some people may find Lufia annoying at first based on the way she talks to the main character sometimes, but as we'll later see, the entire party talks to each other like this. But maybe it's just the localizations of the time having to slash so much text when translating. I find that the simple language used to try and get all the important details in makes those moments harder to take seriously, so it just ends up amusing me a little. On the way out, Roman tells Mixam that Lufia isn't really angry about the pie. It's because he went off and put himself in danger alone. Roman, and even Mixam himself, don't understand his impulse to run off into danger. Roman considers he may have inherited his compulsive heroism from Maxim. Mixam tells Roman to make Lufia some hot milk and let her know that the Prithia flowers she loves so much are in bloom. Back into the castle, I talk to the commander who says he'll send a squad to Sheran right away when he can. But when he can means waiting for a meeting to take place, and then waiting for everyone to agree to go. But before they can even have the meeting, they have to wait for the chairman to return, and he's in Lorbenia, which I've already stated is on a different continent. He doesn't get back until next week. Mixam gets fed up with all the delays and feet dragging and goes off to deal with it himself. I can tell Yuria about the monsters and all the killing they did, and she says that she's still more afraid of Jack right now. I really wish there was a way to help her out. Even Jack, on hearing about the monsters, still thinks his stalking is more important. I leave town once again. Mixam gets moving north again, but this time Lufia follows him. She gets him to admit he's going off to a dangerous place again, and, knowing that telling him not to won't work, she decides she's going with him. Then we go through all the usual, "No, it's too dangerous," but it all sounds so much more childish with Mixam just repeatedly yelling, "No." This is what I mean about the simple language making it more amusing than annoying. Lufia decides that Mixam is just so stubborn that she'll have to ignore him and come along anyway. Plus, she's still mad about the pie. Mixam's all, "I don't even care that you're mad, fine, you can come, just don't blame me if you get yourself killed." Lufia says that she can take care of herself anyway, and Mixam laughs at that claim. They get going, and Lufia starts piling on the guilt, accusing Mixam of not liking her and listing off all of her own flaws, saying she isn't surprised Mixam is tired of her. He comes back by saying that if those things were all it took, he would have been tired of her years ago. He finally drops the act and admits that while he can look after himself, he just doesn't know if he'll be able to keep her safe at the same time. He just wants Lufia to understand that, but she does not. She doesn't care about the danger, and she has the confidence that he'll be able to protect her that he lacks. Mixam says she might die, Lufia says she won't die because she knows he won't let her. When he asks if she always has to have things her own way, she asks if he only just realised that, which has Mixam laughing. That sealed it, and he finally gives in and lets her accompany him, with Lufia asking him to promise to never leave her. That whole thing was just another example of the writing in this localization. I feel if they'd used more complex wording or had voice acting, that whole scene would come across obnoxious and the characters unlikable. But instead, until you reach the very end of it, it comes across very cartoony, like an old sitcom married couple. Make it less simple, and instead Lufia would come across grossly possessive and manipulative, and the protagonist uncaring and patronising. I get to work on levelling Lufia a bit first. She is the mage of the game, low attack and defence but learns the good spells. I also return to Alekia to buy Lufia her own dagger, 9 points stronger than the small knife she starts with. I also give her the bracelet I found for an extra 2 defence. To the armour shop I buy some cloth armour to replace the dress Lufia starts with for 4 more defence. I then stock up on a load of antidotes because I know I'm going to be passing through that cave again. Now that I have more than one party member, groups of enemies can now be bigger. Mixam reaches level 4 and learns the strangely named healing spell, Strong. Lufia reaches level 2 from the next fight. She also starts with Flash, the game's weakest single target thunder spell, and Waken, which cures sleep. Back to the cave to Sheran, and there's an injured man now who says that his sister Lila was in Sheran Castle. He was attacked by the monsters in the cave on his way to check it out. Mixam tells him to go back to Chatham for his own safety. He agrees and gives me a key that Lila used to use at the castle. Back to Sheran, and with the key I can now unlock that door in the throne room and reach the chest containing 100 gold. There's a door in the west too, hiding a switch that I flick. Returning to the basement, I open up some more stairs going deeper. It leads to a prison where the King and Queen of Sheran can be found. After introductions, the king demands to know why there's Alekian knights in his country and why there's only two. Mixam tells him he should be grateful considering the danger and he backs down, to which Lufia is impressed that he would scold a king. Mixam asks if Lila is there, she's the third person in the cell. She's told that her brother, Daniel, asked them to find her. Mixam offers to take them all back to Alekia and the cell is opened. A bookshelf in here holds a great portion. I escort them out of the castle, but as soon as I end up back in Sheran's village, we get surrounded by monsters and the leader, who Lila identifies as the one who killed everyone. The leader recognises Mixam as an Alekian knight, but can tell he's different, as Mixam tells Lufia to take the others to safety. He tells her to go and get the knights as he confronts the leader, asking why he did this. He says he needs no reason other than for the sake of destruction. When Mixam asks if he thinks he'll get away with it, the leader's response is basically, I'm evil? He reveals that he is Gares, the Sinistral of Destruction revived, and the two fight. You cannot win this fight. Gares lets me have a few pity hits first before he responds by dealing over 500 damage to me. That's when Lufia shows up to help out.
You. Woman. You.
These people have such a way with words. He does seem to recognise Lufia though, as her just yelling at Gares to leave them alone actually works and they all teleport out. Mixam's alright considering the damage and asks how the king and the others are. They're all safe in Alekia Castle, but when Mixam asks about the knights, they're all still worthless, so Lufia had to return alone. Considering that fight was 3 turns, Lufia must be fast to run them all the way through that cave, to the other end of the country, and back so fast. But then they have to talk about this guy referring to himself as Gares. This brings up the concern of whether Gares was the only one to come back, or if Dais, Amon, and Erin returned with him. Lufia doesn't even want to know, so for now they decide to return Lila to Chatham and go back to Alekia. We then fade out and back in on their return home, where Roman rushes to Mixam to check if he's alright. They sit in the inn and after hearing that Mixam challenged Gares, Roman asks what the plan is now. After they take Lila home, Mixam plans to journey out even further in search of Gares. Lufia asks Mixam to give her and Roman a moment alone. Before Lufia can get it out, Roman tells her that it's fine for her to go with Mixam. He tells her not to leave him, believing that those two found each other for a reason. Lufia worries about leaving Roman alone, but Roman says that he'll be fine. Lufia promises that she'll come back after everything is over and rejoins Mixam. Inside the castle, Jack is thinking about something other than Uria, as he says that the King of Alekia has promised to help rebuild Sheran. Well, hopefully there were survivors we just didn't see, because otherwise the population would consist of just the King and Queen. Lila is on the second floor in the middle back room, and Mixam tells her that he's taking her back to her brother. Somehow, in the other guest room, there's a fourth survivor with the King and Queen. Where'd she come from? One short trip north back to Chatham later, during which Lufia reaches level 3 and learns the shield spell, I somehow forgot why I was even going to Chatham in the first place and tried to go through the cave to Sheran again, getting a telling off from Lufia for bringing Lila here. I then walk right past Chatham again and check out this building west of Alekia. This place contains a teleporter that takes me to a hub of teleporters leading all around the world. Of course, the rest of them are unavailable right at the start of the game. The old man tells me I'm too early and to come back here later, at least giving me a free heal. I finally remember what I'm doing and take Lila to the east side of Chatham to reunite her with Daniel. Lufia gets all emotional watching their reunion and they approach the two to thank them for their help. Lila says that it's just a rumour, but she has heard that there's a person in the town Treck who knows about the Sinistrals. Treck is a good distance southwest of Sheran. Talking to the old man in the field, who is happy to see Daniel and Lila together again, has him give me a speed potion. I save it for now. So he's back through the cave to Sheran again. On the way back through, Lufia reaches level 4. Back outside Sheran, I keep moving west, across this bridge. A few steps later and I get my first new enemy of the area, the anemone. This pair gets Mixam to level 5. I continue west through a small desert and then south across another bridge. Another new enemy, Earwig. Spiders are still sticking around though. I get moving southwest through this narrow mountain range and come out the other side to find the town Treck. The first sailor I talk to tells me the monsters have captured more ships that sail to Lorbenia. It's a pain, sounds like a massive understatement. The first house to the west has a hairband I can steal, it's 2 more defense to Lufia. Upstairs is a chest, and that's the second dress I've stolen in this game. Is this a hobby of Mixam's or something? While stocking up on antidotes, I also buy a few shrieks, the item that cures confusion. South of the item shop, the weapon shop has a power guard to take from a shelf. This is a battle item that grants a temporary attack boost. I buy a 180 gold long knife to give Lufia 5 extra attack points and sell off a few bits of outdated equipment. The armor shop is connected and I buy Lufia a robe for 260 gold that grants 3 more defense than the cloth armor. There's a bar on the west end of town that sells 3 different ciders that all grant minor healing and a temporary attack boost in battle. I do like me some cider, but I don't drink it that often anymore. Can't stand the acid reflux I always get from it. A woman says that an old man at the port used to be a knight in the Guy Legion. Guy as in Maxim's comrade, who is still alive even into his 120s. Upstairs is a sailor who is fine with all the ship theft as long as his own precious Maberia is still doing fine. Everyone else has had their livelihood sabotaged, but he's still doing good. To the south end of town is the port. Going west takes me to the cellar of the bar where I can buy more cider from the old man. Underneath all these crates is a hidden escape and swing wing. In the southwest of the cellar are a pair of chests with arrows and a smoke ball. The owner of the Maberia is also on the port now, still bragging about his puny boat. It's the same size as him. There's an old man to the east who can sense an unusual energy from Mixam, asking if he's fought a strong enemy lately. He can tell because he's the knight who used to be in the Guy Legion. When asked if he knows anything about Gades, he's surprised to see someone so young who even knows of the Sinistrals. He's taken aback when Mixam tells him that he fought Gades. He asks why Mixam would even want to know more instead of fearing for his life. But once Mixam says that he's Maxim's descendant, I really made a mistake with that name. The old man has them follow him to the house I stole the hairband and dress from. He calls over his niece Aenea and tells her to escort Mixam and Lufia to the East Cave to meet The One. She worries because The One refuses to meet anyone, but the old man knows that he will meet Maxim's descendant. Aenea joins me and I leave town. Outside of town I get two new enemies from my first fight, Nettles and Baby Crab. To reach the East Cave I have to go east from Treck, making sure I go south around the mountains. I cross the bridge leading south and keep moving east, across another bridge and facing my first boar worm. East a little more to find the entrance to the East Cave. Starting from the west I move east and south down two ladders, then east to a chest and south down the stairs to the next floor. Then south down another ladder and north through a door. Northwest to a second chest, then up another ladder to reach the exit. First battle here is another new enemy, Kobold. Killing them gets Lufia to level 5, teaching her Dew, the weakest water spell. One thing I really like in the menus whenever I go to heal is that it tells how many castings of a spell I have left based on my current MP. So at Mixam's current maximum MP of 22, he has 7 castings of Strong. The first chest has a pair of cloth shoes, I give them to Lufia for 2 more defense. When I get to the door on the second floor, Aenea unlocks it for me, so you couldn't get through without advancing the story at Treck first. The second chest has a swing wing for me, but not long after a team of 3 boar worms and a spider gang up on Mixam and kill him. Lufia manages to get them down to just 1 worm, but she's killed too. Full party deaths in this game also follow Dragon Quest rules. Appear back at the last priest you saved at with a chunk of your money gone, plus only the main character alive so you have to spend more money on reviving your dead party members. Only this time there's this ghost fairy thing that does it for you. That left me with just 27 gold. This is one of those RPGs where it's the early game that's the hardest part, where teams of the game's weaker monsters can still kill you. Next time I make it through the East Cave alive. There's just a single house on the other side of these mountains. Before I go inside, I run off to the east to find this sword in a field to swipe a short sword, a 20 point attack increase for Mixam over the dagger. Inside the house, Aenea tells the old man that she has brought him a descendant of Maxim. He asks Mixam to focus his thoughts on a single thing so he can read Mixam's energy, and comes to the conclusion that he is a descendant of Maxim. He introduces himself as Guy. That he's managed to keep his natural blonde hair at 120 something may be even more impressive than actually living to that age. I'm over 100 but still kicking is the most fate tempting line I've ever seen in a game. He cannot believe Mixam when he tells him that Gades is still around and that he fought him. When Lufia sticks up for Mixam, Guy finds something interesting about her. Mixam asks for any knowledge Guy has of Gades. Guy says it hurts to try and remember that far back, so he's going to have to get back out there. After all, he's over 100 but still kicking. But then he takes 3 steps and starts dying. I don't think Guy's death was supposed to be as funny as it came off. With his last words, he tells Mixam to find Arteia for help instead. Arteia is an elf, so he lives far longer than Guy would. He says that there's a person in the town Grenoble who knows how to find Arteia. And he dies while telling Mixam to never give up. Then I see where he's buried. Did I just steal from Guy's grave? You can take the sword after he dies. But then again, that grave was already there. Did he have a wife buried there already, or did he dig his own grave ahead of time so that it was ready? Aenea asks what Mixam will do now, but all he can do is follow Guy's instructions and head for Grenoble to find out where Arteia is. Mixam goes off and Lufia begins to follow until Aenea stops her. She tells her it's possible that only one of Maxim's bloodline can defeat the Sinistrals and asks her to stay close to Mixam and keep him safe. That support is just as important as any weapon. Lufia says that she will never let Mixam get hurt and seems to stop short of saying that she loves him. but Aenea asks Lufia to be careful herself as well. I leave Aenea at Guy's grave and raid his bookshelf for a great portion. I mean, he doesn't need it anymore. Asking Aenea about Grenoble has her say that it's west of Lorbenia, but with no more ships going from Treck to Lorbenia, we have a problem. Now for the journey back to Treck. There's still more new enemies in the East Cave, a giant bat. They get Mixam to level 6. Nothing else happens on the way back to Treck. I tell Aenea's uncle about the plan to find Arteia. Strangely, we never tell him about Guy, he never asks, nor does he ask why we've returned alone without his non-combatant niece. He says that there are some soldiers from Lorbenia here asking about the Sinistrals, and says I should try talking to them. I go back to the port to talk to the knights. The green-haired one is the commander of the Lorbenian army, Agaro. When he heard that Gades attacked Sheran, he came straight over here. When Mixam says that he has fought Gades, Agaro tells him to come to his camp so he can tell him more. But right then, another ship rises up and sinks the Lorbenian ship. The demons get off and we get our first boss fight against 4 demon lords. Agaro also joins the party at level 5. He's the heavy hitter with no magical ability. This boss fight was where my first attempt at playing this game ended 20 years ago. I was actually a very shitty RPG player as a kid with no real patience to learn how to play most of them. I just wanted to explore the worlds, hear the music and see the stories. Solo Final Fantasy playthroughs that weren't joint efforts with my mum or grandmother consisted of me running from every fight and then spamming summons on bosses, praying that I win this time. So for this game, as I did with many RPGs, I basically ran from every fight until I got to this one that you cannot escape from. I got destroyed and then played something else. I also misremembered a lot of the game between Maxim's prologue and this fight. Everything to do with Sheran I forgot completely. I thought we went straight from Alekia to Treck. I also somehow forgot Guy died. I always thought he went off ahead and got beaten up by the demon lords at Treck, forcing the party to take over. It's strange how the memory works. As for this boss, the demon lords have 48 HP each, and the inability to target individuals in the group is a huge pain here. I have Agaro attack because that's all he can do. Mixam attack unless someone needs to heal, and Lufia cast Do. Do is the most useful attack here since it hits every enemy in a group, so even if I can't target, all of them are still taking damage. Thing is, Mixam and Agaro are still spreading out their attacks as much as possible instead of ganging up on a single one. And the demon lords have Do, which hits my entire party and makes it harder to keep up with healing. If they all decided to use Do at once, I would be in huge trouble. After I kill one of the demon lords, they kill Mixam, taking out my only party member with healing magic. I decide to just leave him dead and try to end the fight. The second and third demon lords die quite close together. The fourth takes a little longer because they also have healing spells and it undid all the damage I'd done to it until it was the last one left. Mixam misses out on the XP as Lufia reaches level 6, as does Agaro. Agaro has never seen someone wield a sword as well as Mixam. When he learns that he's Maxim's descendant, he understands how he had the guts to take on Gades himself. Mixam tells Agaro that his goal is to kill Gades and the other Sinistrals if they've returned. Mixam fills Agaro in on the plan and Agaro allows them the use of his ship. That is, until he is reminded that the demon lord sank it. So the next objective is to find a ship. I use the great potions I've been saving up on Agaro. He's purely used for attacking, so he could do with the strength boosts the most. Since I have some more money now, I return to the armor shop and buy Agaro a cloth helm. I speak to the captain of the Maberia again. It seems his ship was stolen since the last time I spoke to him. He's heard it was seen on a small island to the west that can only be reached on foot by travelling through a dangerous cave. So it's time to get travelling north, around the western edge of the continent. I eventually make it to the cave to Maberia. This one will take a few images. I start by going all the way east and north of the ladder, then all the way west across the bridge to get this first chest, then northwest of the stairs down to the first basement, where I'll go southeast for two more chests. Here's where I get into another of my bigger complaints with the game now we're at a bigger dungeon. When in towns, you walk at quite a speedy pace, yet as soon as you enter a dungeon, you suddenly walk at half speed. I'm not sure why this decision was made, but the only theory I have is that since this game has such a high encounter rate, high even when compared to similar games of the time, your movement speed was slowed in dungeons to make it less obvious. Don't know for sure if that's the case, but it's my guess. The first chest is a potion. The two in the basement are a potion and a power potion. Power potion goes to Lufia to try and make up for her low HP. I then return to the first floor. I walk west and fall down this pit to land back in the basement between two teleporters. I take the northern one and follow the path it takes me to north, east, south down a ladder, and north through a door to the room with a waterfall. Said room has two tiles that will fully heal me between them. On the way back, Agaro reaches level 7. I also finally get a new enemy in the green orb. Back to the two teleporters, the southern one takes me back to the start. From the start, I go east and north under the bridge to go down the stairs back down to the basement. I move south, picking up a hidden item in the pool of poison, then turn west and go through the door to find the final chest of this dungeon. Then I follow the rest of the floor west and then north of the ladder to find the stairs that take me back to the first floor past the pit and allow me to go west to get out of here. Mixam reaches level 7 from the next fight, learning Float. Lufia also reaches level 7 and learns Strong. That timing with Float couldn't be any more perfect, as otherwise I'd have no way to avoid the damage done by these poison tiles yet. But now I can cast Float and walk over them to grab the miracle in the poison. Through the door, this cave's final treasure is a Dais ring. It increases defense by 8 and magic defense by 4, so I let Agaro wear it. The rest of the dungeon goes smoothly, with me lucky enough to not get any more encounters before I leave. I end up outside on the island the captain mentioned, and there is the Maberia. Monsters followed us out of the cave though, and my next boss fight is against 3 goblins. The goblins have 118 HP each. I start by throwing out the mid arrows I have. They're pretty good for now as they take around half of the HP of each goblin they hit. If only I could make them both hit the same one. After that, it's attacking, casting do, and healing when I can. Of course, while I can't target a single opponent, the enemies can, and so they gang up on Mixam and quickly beat him to death. Even when I kill one of them, they're strong enough that I can't spare a turn reviving him until a second is dead. And even then, he's almost killed the second he revives, but clings on with 1 HP. Soon after, I kill the final goblin, getting Agaro to level 8. The party realises it was the goblins who stole the Maberia, and they sail it back to Treck. I pack the boat and go tell the captain that I got his ship back. He zooms off to the port and we follow. As thanks, he'll offer 3 trips to Lorbenia, and I take that offer. Lorbenia is southeast of Treck, southwest of Alekia, and directly south from that teleporting building. Agaro leaves the party for a while to request the Lorbenian army dispatched to fight Gades. When he asks what Mixam will do, Lufia interrupts and decides that they're doing some sightseeing. She wants to see those new addresses I heard about back in Alekia. Agaro says he'll meet with them in the inn later and sets off. To the east is a woman whose boyfriend, a sailor, has just left. She just loves hearing about his adventures. Southwest towards a huge shop in the middle of town, I inspect the back of the weapons and armor sign to find a mind potion. I give it to Mixam. There are smaller weapon and armor shops to the west, the weapon shop's bookshelf having a mid-arrow for the taking. I spend 360 gold on a staff for Lufia, 13 points stronger than the long knife. At the armor shop, 480 gold for a tan armor and 240 for a tan helm, both for Mixam. The tan armor being 8 points more defenses over the cloth armor and the tan helm 3 points more than the cloth helm. Into the big shop and up to the second floor, I can buy some cheap jewellery here for Lufia, but the defence isn't worth the money. In the southeast is a chest containing some sweet water. Another shop up here sells stuffed animals. We've seen the stuffed bear, but the stuffed pig confuses an enemy, while the stuffed dog paralyses them. Onto the third floor, and Lufia is fascinated by all the dresses. Mixam tries to go along with it and show interest, until a dress Lufia likes is 5,800 gold. In this case, Lufia takes his side. But then she gets going again in the back room when the staff says that there's a sale on. That's when a kid charges past her and then sneaks off. But Mixam knew what was going on and demands he give back the gold he pickpocketed from Lufia. Lufia catches up in time to witness Mixam preparing to hand a child over to the army for punishment. Lufia can't let him go that extreme and says that they already have enough money. No, we don't. I just spent nearly everything on the new equipment. Lufia will allow the kid to keep the money as long as he promises to never do it again. Mixam thinks Lufia is too kind, but Lufia knows that he must have a reason to steal. I go to the inn, where the innkeeper asks if I had a run-in with Lu too. Everyone is aware of that kid. He's the son of the famous Professor Rael Shire. All he can say about him is that he's travelling the world researching something weird. The journey was too dangerous, so he left Lu at home unsupervised. Lu steals because Rael's business doesn't pay very well, and Rael doesn't send Lu any money anyway. So people tend to just let him do what he wants. And to think, Mixam wanted this abandoned, penniless child to have a military trial. Outside the inn, Agaro catches up with us. He wants to join Mixam on his quest to destroy the Sinistrals. They ask if the army will be okay without him. Turns out Agaro asked the army to take on the Sinistrals, but they can't be asked, so Agaro can't stand to be part of it anymore. That's both militaries we've seen now. I gotta say, that's a creative way to get the armies out of the way. Instead of the usual getting wiped out early, or no explanation, just standing around while the party solve everything, just have them all be lazy. Our next destination is Grenoble, which Agaro says is to the southwest, so we set off. I stay outside of Lorbenia for a bit to build back up my annihilated wallet. New enemy is a big newt pellet swap, the giant newt. Mixam reaches level 8 from that fight, and the next one introduces 2 new enemies at once, Ruzard and Rat. That fight gets Lufia to level 8. Once I have enough money, I buy a 450 gold tan robe for Lufia, 4 points more defense than the normal robe. I then sell more obsolete equipment for a 180 gold tan shield. This is Mixam's first shield for an extra 5 defense. Back to farming money. Next new enemy is the Mini Demon, a palette swap of the Demon Lord. 6 minutes later, Mixam reaches level 9. I can now buy Agaro his own tan armour. One more fight outside gets me the 460 gold for a glass cap. 2 more defense over the hairband for Lufia. The next battle gets Lufia to level 9, teaching her Drain, which lowers enemy defense. That got me the money for Agaro's tan helm. I can now finally get going towards Grenoble. First, south past these mountains and the forest. Then a long stretch west past some ponds until the town comes into view, with a big cave slightly north of it. Just before I can get to town, Agaro reaches level 9. After that fight, I finally enter Grenoble. I talk to the first person I see and ask him if he knows anyone who knows about Arteia. He says that an old man in the spring basement may know. East into the weapon shop, I can take a potion from one of the cabinets. Upstairs in the inn, a woman says that there is a treasure in the old cave that only women can find. We'll get to the old cave in a bit. The man up here gives me a hint towards items being hidden in poison. In the house behind the inn, a guy asks if I've heard of the rumours and will only let me pass the 50 gold. I pay him, take a speed potion from his bookshelf and go down the stairs. Following the tunnel to the stairs going up has me reach this garden on the northern end of town where I could find a spell potion in these flowers. Slightly to the east are more stairs going down into this room. This place relates to the old cave, that cave a little north of town. There are several floors to it, but I only gain access to a new floor every 5 levels. Since my party are at level 9, that's just the second floor, the first floor being the entrance. The old cave is a dungeon with each floor filled with several treasures, including a main one that has no purpose other than to be brought back to this room and sold for a high price. There's an old man in here who I can ask about Arteia. He says he knows about Arteia, but before he gives us that information, he wants the fairy key's treasure from the old cave's second floor. Since only a woman can get it, he hasn't been able to. Talking to the guy behind the counter, he says that if I find the secret map on that same floor, he'll buy it off me for 500 gold. That's about it for Grenoble, most of the rest of them only talk about treasure hunting in the old cave. And so it's my turn to check out the old cave now. The guy on the first floor behind the counter tells me to enter the lift and choose the floor I want. Since I can only go to the second floor, I choose that one. I start by moving all the way south, grabbing 6 chests on the way. See that item marked 7, hidden in the poison? I missed that one for now. Then east into another room, grabbing 3 more chests and 2 inside the room. Back to the fork where the 4th chest was, I go east to the wall, getting 4 more chests before I take the southeast turn to find 2 more in the corner. Then back to the north, and northeast into another room for the remaining 5 chests. The first chest is empty, the second has a high magic which restores a decent amount of MP. The third chest is a potion, the fourth is an antidote. 5th chest is empty, as is the 6th chest. Other people have been here before, which is why some chests have already been raided. Thing is, I knew that the item in the poison was hidden there, as I cast Float to go grab it, but then I just forget and walk right past it. The 3 chests while going east to that door are empty, a potion, and a sleep arrow. The 2 in that little room are the secret map and a power ring. I give that to Mixam for a 10-point attack increase. The chests on the east side of the room are empty, the Float spell in item form, empty, and a pair of cloth shoes to replace Mixam's sandal. Now he can wear something on both feet. The 2 chests in the southeast corner are a tan shield that goes to Agaro and a dragon egg. These will be important, but not for a long time. Know why the fairy kiss can only be found by women? There's a sign next to the door. The door is wide open though, and there's no one here, so I don't know who's enforcing it, but either way, Lufia has to go in alone. One chest contains a dress. I didn't bring it up before, but there are still random encounters here, which is a problem when Lufia is alone and you can get ambushed by a group. The other chests are a hairband, heeled shoes, fairy kiss, and earring. I have Lufia rejoin the group and I can leave for now. I return to Grenoble, and one minor annoyance is that you have to pay that guy 50 gold every time you want to go back to the shop concerning the old cave. I give the old man that fairy kiss, which he claims to have been after for 40 years. He says that to find Arteia I need to go to the tower northwest of this town. There's a man there who knows about Arteia. He gives me a letter, as otherwise he would refuse to talk to me. The man was Arteia's apprentice, so if anyone should know where he is, it's him. The woman behind the counter takes the treasures you're told to find, giving me the 500 gold for the secret map. I decide to get going straight for that tower, starting by moving west from Grenoble and across the bridge. This is where I find that weaker versions of the goblin bosses are now regular enemies. I then get moving north along the edge of these mountains, I get a new crab variant, the mini crab. Apparently, I'm very bad at following instructions, as I then go east at the first bridge. That does not lead to the tower, it leads back to Lorbenia. I eventually realise my mistake and get moving north along the mountains again. Eventually, I get close to the very tip of the continent and the tower comes into view. Since Mixam is already running low on MP, I give my spell potions to him. Soon after, I enter the northwest tower. I start by moving west and north, taking the first northeast turn through a door. I then follow that path around to the room with my first chest. I return to the start and go east and north through a door, then east and north through another to two more chests. Then back south and west to go north to the stairs up to floor 2. The first chest is a sonic ring, which I give to Lufia for 5 more agility and 1 more defence. The fight after gets Mixam to level 10, teaching him Drain as well. I get my first new enemy here in the form of the Red Magi. Two fights later, I face my first zombies too. I start using the sweet water I built up here in the hopes of less battles, but it really doesn't make any difference. A group of 4 Red Magi is a nightmare with their spamming of the spell Spark, hitting the entire party. The fight ends with Mixam and Lufia at 1 HP and Agaro dead. Lufia reaches level 10 though. I have enough items to heal everyone though, so I can avoid having to flee back to Grenoble. The other two chests on this first floor are a high potion, then one step in front of the second to end up fighting my first huge bunnies. The other chest is a high magic. Floor 2 now. First I go south and east to get the first chest. Next back to the stairs and go southwest and up the stairs to an isolated section of floor 3. There I go all the way east, stopping in each of the rooms for a total of 4 more chests before I return to floor 2 the way I came. The first chest has a smoke ball. Onto the southern end of floor 3, the first two chests are a mind guard that temporarily boosts intelligence in battle, and a power guard. The third chest is a high potion. Then I'm told my sweet water ran out, having forgot I even used one for all the good it did. The fourth chest is a revive, then I return to floor 2. From the southwest of floor 2 I go all the way north, east through 2 doors, south past a turn east, then east at the end to grab 2 more chests behind 2 more doors. I then go back to that eastern turn and follow it to the stairs to the rest of floor 3. From there I go anti-clockwise around the floor, walking past the stairs to floor 4, until I reach a narrow room with 2 more chests. I then go back and take those stairs I walked past. First fight back on floor 2 gets Agaro to level 10. The remaining two chests on this floor are a Mind Potion used on Lufia, and a Great Potion used on Agaro. A million fights later, I make it onto floor 3. I get another new enemy up here, the Fight. No really, that's his name. In the room with the chest is a plaque telling me to overcome my fear. The chest contains a Spell Potion and a Power Potion. Two fights later on the way to floor 4, Mixam reaches level 11. And now to floor 4. The aim is the room directly north of the stairs, but there's a pair of chests behind it, so I grab those first and then go into the room. Both chests contain mid arrows. Then through that door to find a bedroom with Arteya's former apprentice inside. How do you live here with all the monsters? I swap Mixam and Lufia's sonic and power rings and talk to him. He gets angry at us for interrupting his practice until we give him the letter from the old man. The old man helped him out when he was young, but despite that, he says he can't tell the party where Arteya is, unless Mixam can defeat him in a one-on-one fight. After healing up, I accept his challenge. The apprentice has 313 HP. I start by using the sleep arrow I found a while earlier to put him to sleep. While he sleeps, I use a power guard to boost Mixam's attack, then drain to lower the apprentice's defence. Then 4 turns in, I get attacking, dealing between 30 and 40 damage. I manage to take 142 HP from him before he wakes up. He casts Fake on himself for a minor agility boost, but after that it becomes mostly a damage race. By some coincidence, we both choose to heal at the same time too, but I'm dealing more damage and healing myself for more than he is. So when he starts wasting turns on potions that my very next attack invalidates, he can't keep up, and once the buffs and debuffs wear off, I finish him off with a mid arrow. The apprentice can tell by the way Mixam kicked his ass that he is a good person, and tells him that Arteya is in Elfreya, the village of elves. Humans are not allowed in without an elf helper. He says that to get to Elfreya, I have to go south and cross a desert. Then we get what I think is a typo. He says Elfreya is on a small island surrounded by 3 islands. That could be true if you look at a map of the world, but it makes more sense if he means an island surrounded by 3 towers. Even then, Elfreya is still miles away with at least 3 towns between the northwest tower and it. To help Mixam out, the apprentice gives him a speed potion that I then hoard. Out of the room, I can walk off this ledge on the north end of the floor to drop myself outside. I could head for the next town, but with my party now at level 10, I can access a new level of the old cave, so I return to Grenoble. On the way back, Lufia reaches level 11 and learns Deflect, which inflicts silence on an enemy. Back to the shop in Grenoble, and the man behind the counter tells me to find the silver wick on the third floor in exchange for 1,000 gold. And so he's back into the old cave and taking that lift down to the third floor. It is possible to grind yourself high enough to get access to all the floors right away and then steamroll a good chunk of the game with the items you get from the lower levels, but that grind this early on sounds horribly tedious. To start with, south to grab 5 chests, one of which is in a toxic pool. Then north through a door for 4 more, and through another door north for another 2. Back out of that door and east to the next door. In the next room, southeast, getting 3 more chests and an item hidden in poison, west for another, then down a ladder for 2 more. East for another, north for another, and through a door to a room with 6 chests. Then north again into one last room with 5 more chests. In the first room are a high potion, a bomb which deals minor damage to all enemies, empty, sour cider, a new enemy in the Draku Rose that likes to poison my party, then a magic guard which grants a large temporary magic defense boost. Into the second room for an empty chest, an escape, and 2 more empty chests. The side room to the north has an empty chest and a revive. Onto the third room for an empty, smoke ball, miracle in the poison, empty, sweet water, high arrows, float, high magic, and high potion. As for the fourth room, Brawn Breast, a 7-point defense upgrade over Lufia's bracelet, my first frog enemy, another joke armor in the apron, revive, a broadsword which is cursed so I ignore it, empty, and Brawn Helm. I think Brawn may be bronze under a character limit. Agaro reaches level 11 from a fight with 4 frogs. Mixam gets the Brawn Helm for 6 more defense over the Tan Helm. Then to the final floor, empty, spike shoes which replace Agaro's cloth shoes and grant 5 more attack, empty, the Silver Wick, and the Water Ring. This goes to Lufia to increase the damage caused by her water spells. Mixam gets the Power Ring back. On the way out, Mixam reaches level 12. I return to Grenoble and trade that Silver Wick for my 1,000 gold. After selling off outdated and cursed equipment, I get going on the long journey to reach Elfreya. I get back up to the tip of the mountains where the Northwest Tower is and start moving around the west of the mountains. Once I reach the bottom, I cross a bridge facing my first spiked newt and cross another bridge going west. I continue west until I can cross another bridge going south. As a small village comes into view, Lufia reaches level 12. I then enter the village, Kirof. To start with, the inn is to the west and I can raid the shelves in the back for mid arrows, high arrows, and a bomb. I'm not going to ask what that's doing next to a bed in the inn. A kid says that there's a rumour that the cave north of the village is haunted by ghosts. In the house behind the inn, an old woman shows her jealousy of a girl, Raina, who had just turned 10 and wishes they could trade places, wishing she could take her place and in return inflict her advanced age onto a child. I help myself to the old woman's plum cider on the bookshelf. Then there's the item shop where the shopkeeper says that he's closing because his daughter is ill. I inspect his shelves and take a high potion and sweet water, then go into the back to see the ill daughter. This is Raina, and then I realise that I judged the old woman too quickly. She meant she wished they could trade places so that the child was well and healthy and the old woman had her illness instead. She tells her friend, Mark, that no medicine has ever worked for her, but Mark says that his town has a ruby called the Hope Ruby that grants wishes and that he'll bring it to her. Raina knows of it, and also knows that it's one of the treasures of the kingdom Medan. Mark thinks they'll just lend the priceless treasure to him if he asks, and sets off back to Medan. I talk to Raina as she worries about Mark potentially doing something stupid, to which Lufia teases her by asking if Mark is her boyfriend. Turns out he actually is. This 10-year-old has the dedication to travel alone from another kingdom to visit his ill girlfriend. Even if Medan isn't very far from here, it's still dangerous for a kid, so it's very impressive and puts most adults to shame. But you know how I treat gravely ill kids? I steal their toys. A stuffed dog from the bookshelf and a stuffed pig from the cabinet. I leave town and get moving east until I can see a castle. This is the Kingdom of Medan. The first person I talk to says that the Hope Ruby is inside the castle. In the item shop, while stocking up, I can now buy myself some mystery pins which cure paralysis. In the house east of the inn, both bookshelves have items, an escape and a swing wing. The owner of the house noticed Mark ringing off to the castle as soon as he returned from Kirof. At the weapon shop, I buy 2 spears for 780 gold each and a mace for 600 gold. I also stock up on a few bombs. The spears are for Mixam and Agaro for a nice 14-point attack increase over their short swords. The mace is for Lufia, 8 points stronger than the staff. Armour shop next. 2 chain mails for 960 gold each, a wood shield for 360 gold, and a wood helm for 450 gold. The chain mails are also for Mixam and Agaro, 4 points stronger than the tan armour. Mixam also gets the wood shield, 2 points more than the tan shield, while Agaro gets the wood helm, 3 points over the tan helm. The house west of the church used to be the item shop belonging to Raina's father, but when she got ill, they moved to the more peaceful Kirof. I head towards the castle to see Mark running out. It turns out that when the 10-year-old asked the king for one of the kingdom's prized possessions and tourist attractions, he said no. He has no idea what to do and leaves. I head into the castle myself. I root around in the flowers outside to the east to find an X-Magic that restores a party member's full MP. I enter the castle properly and keep moving north through several doors to find the Hope Ruby. A knight tells me that throwing a coin into the spring and making a wish will have it come true. It's just a fancy royal wishing well. One guy says that it works, but a woman on the other side of the room has said that her wish has never come true. If I approach it, Lufia decides to make a wish. She tells Mixem to ask what she wished for, so he does, and she says she won't tell. Out of this room and to the east and north is a set of stairs going down. There's a very large basement, and should I follow the path all the way, I get to listen in on a conversation between the princess and a knight. It turns out that the knight has been pocketing all the coins thrown into the spring. He replies that, of course he has, it's a scam and that's his job. The princess finds the whole thing sad, even the Hope Ruby is just made of glass. It seems Medan is 100% funded by those making wishes on the Hope Ruby. But the princess knows they can't keep it up forever and that Medan will have to rely on something other than a scam. Her own wish is for the Hope Ruby to be broken. Back into town only to see Mark run out of the castle again, followed by a knight. When Mixam asks what's going on, another knight says that the Hope Ruby was stolen. Mixam and Lufia refuse to believe that Mark could steal it despite the desperation he has shown to get it. So I head back to Kirof. I find Mark at the entrance, claiming that Rayna has disappeared. She's not even supposed to be well enough to stand. The party tell Mark to wait here, but he gives away that he stole the Hope Ruby by saying he promised to show it to her. Lufia tells Mark that the ruby has no power, and Mixam decides to let him tag along. I get moving north of Kirof to this cave. The guy outside says that Rayna went in there looking strange, so we go in. The Ghost Cave is the most complex dungeon we've had so far. From the stairs I enter from, I go southeast to find a chest. Then east, skipping one ladder and going up the next. I do an anti-clockwise lap around this lower section, entering two small rooms for a chest each, grabbing one in the southeast corner, getting one in a side room to the east, and then going back up the ladder. To the northeast corner next for a room with another chest, and the middle north room for one more. Then it's down that first ladder I skipped, and southwest for the stairs down to the next floor. My first new enemy here is a trio of sword ghosts, the Sword Spook. The next fight gets me two more newcomers, the Will-O-Wisp and Crazy Pot. The Crazy Pots can be annoying, hitting the entire party with the Frost spell. The first chest is a high potion. The next battle is another new ghost, the Flame Spook. Thankfully, Lufia's Dew destroys them. The first chest in a southern room is a monster ring, which increases the random encounter rate when equipped. Fuck that. The second one is a ghost ring, which lets me deal extra damage to ghosts. I let Mixam have it while I'm in here and give Agaro the power ring. The chest in the southeast corner contains 500 gold. The chest in the eastern room has a miracle. Another new ghost to fight after that, the Ghost Mail. This place has had the largest amount of new enemies than any other location so far. On the way to the next chest, Agaro reaches level 12. That chest in the northeast room has a chain cloth. It goes to Lufia for 3 more defense of the tan robe. The chest in the northern room has another escape. Then it's down to the next floor. I grab the chest north of the stairs I enter from and go down the stairs to the southeast into a short tunnel going east with another chest at the end. And then up more stairs to reach a section with another chest. The chest north of those stairs has a revive. Next to that is a pair of recovery tiles. The next chest in that short tunnel has enemies that get Mixam to level 13 and teach him the poison spell. The chest has a wood shield, so Agaro can have one too. Up the stairs at the end of the tunnel, the chest has a high magic. I then go back through the tunnel. I next go down the stairs just northeast of the ones I came from, then east through a little tunnel to a room with another chest. I then take the northeast stairs here and go through another tiny tunnel to reach a second chest. The chest through the tiny tunnel is a high magic. Through the second is a dragon egg. I then return to the section with the high magic and take the southeastern stairs to an even tinier room with more stairs down to the bottom floor. In this room is just a small walk northwest to a chest with a speed potion inside. I then backtrack all the way back to the first floor. I go back northeast of the ladder and then south down the path between the ladders, east at the end, north through a door to find a chest and some stairs back down to the second floor. In the same fight where Lufia reaches level 13 and learns Bang, the weakest explosion type spell, a Sword Spook drops a scimitar. This is a rarish drop and a very good one for this point in the game. It's 37 points stronger than Mixam's spear. The chest next to the stairs has a revive. Now I'm on a slightly elevated section of this second floor. From the stairs, it's south to a chest, then east to another above this ladder. Then north and east to a third chest, then back to the ladder and down it. After that, I go all the way east into this room with two sets of stairs down into the bottom floor. I take the eastern one first. That first chest to the south of the stairs has a high potion. The one east of it is another high potion. A third high potion from the chest in the northeast. This section of the bottom floor has two chests, a spell potion and a power potion. Then there's two doors leading to a treasure each. The eastern door leads to a great potion, and the western one a mind potion. This room also has a knight who has been injured by monsters, so I have Lufia heal him. He gives me the secret that things in this cave are not what they appear to be. Back to the second floor, I take the western set of stairs down to the bottom floor. No need for a map here, I go down the set of stairs southeast from where I enter. North of the stairs it leads to is a chest with a smoke ball, with a chest holding an escape to the southwest. Back to the previous room, of the three southern sets of stairs I take the middle one. It looks like a dead end, but the injured knight's hint was referring to an invisible bridge I can cross to the north. Across the bridge is one last chest containing a revive, and I continue north into the final room. Up one last ladder, and I find Reyna. Matt goes to her, but then a ghost reveals itself, saying that now the Hope Ruby will belong to it. Apparently it's been waiting for this thing for a long time and won't let the party stop it. The Phantasm has 657 HP. I start by giving Mixam a Power Guard, draining its defence, and just having Aggro attack as usual. The Phantasm will either cast Spark or try to put the party to sleep. The combination of New Scimitar, Ghost Ring, Power Guard, and Drain has Mixam's regular attack deal over 100 damage, just under a sixth of the Phantasm's maximum HP. Then I get stuck for a few turns with the entire party being put to sleep while it beats the shit out of them. With the way targeting works in this game when it's the enemies to you, the sleep status will drive you up the wall in situations like this. Aggro wakes up but can't heal Lufia before he's killed. Luckily a miracle will actually work on a downed party member, and as soon as Mixam wakes up, he and Lufia get confused. Okay, forget just sleep. All status effects are unbearable in this game when the enemy can just inflict on the entire party at once. I cure Mixam of it and have Aggro continue to heal him while Mixam beats the Phantasm's head in. Lufia gets no luck though. If she isn't confused, she's put to sleep. There's no greater joy in this game than when an arsehole enemy just uses their single target physical attack. Eventually, Mixam gets the killing blow and reaches level 14, with Aggro reaching level 13. Reyna wakes up, having no idea where she is. Lufia reaches the conclusion that medicine never worked on Reyna because the ghost kidnapped her. But then surely that would only apply to just now when she was already sick long before that. I think she means the Phantasm was keeping Reyna ill to bait someone into stealing the Hope Ruby to try and use on her. The Hope Ruby was broken during the battle, don't see how when Mark wasn't involved in the fight. But Reyna is no longer ill now, so it doesn't matter. Mark decides that the only thing they can do is tell the truth to the people of Medan, apologise and hope they're forgiven. Lufia suggests he apologise to the princess, as she's the one who'll understand. Aggro says she might even reward Mark for breaking it. The party take the kids back to Kirof, where they'll have to leave them now to go find Elfreya. Mark can give us some advice by telling us that there are elves living in the town Belgen, since we need an elf to get to Elfreya. It's southeast of Medan. Mark's father went there once and is aware of at least one elf woman who lives there. Talking to Reyna's father has him thank me with a power potion. I return to Medan. In the town, the princess is coming clean to the citizens about the Hope Ruby being a scam. The reason the kingdom went with it is because Medan used to be rich from a gemstone mine. But once they cleared out that mine, the only solution they had left to make money was tourism, and so the Hope Ruby was fought up. But the princess says it was wrong, and that everyone in the kingdom should pitch in to make legitimate money. I mean, I imagine these normal people all have actual jobs already. Most of the town's population of 8 here do run small businesses. I doubt they were making much money themselves from the royal wishing well. I was on the princess's side until that part, back when it looked like she just wanted to end a scam. But now, under the guise of not lying to them anymore, she's expecting them to work even harder for less reward. I doubt she's going to see any negative effects from this. Of course, these people are either gullible or total sycophants, and they say that they are in the wrong too for allowing the royal family to lie to them without their knowledge. You know what? This country deserves bankruptcy. Since that old man there is out of Reyna's old house, I can take a high potion from his bookshelf. This treasure can only be obtained right now. Leave and the old man will be back in front of it and it will be unobtainable forever. I talk to the princess, who says that Mark has apologised and the guards at the cave to the east have been told to let me through. I leave this kingdom behind to fall apart, never looking back. Slightly northeast of town is the cave to Belgen. This one is simple. I go all the way east, over a pool of poison, to reach two chests. Then back west a bit and north across a bridge, then east again to exit through the other side. Those two chests are a revive and a high potion. The guards are at the bridge still. Normally they will be blocking the bridge, but now they've moved aside. Out on the other side of the mountains, and the first ghost mail I kill drops a light armour. It's 8 points stronger than the chain mail, so I give it to Mixam. I move south, quickly finding another village. This is Belgen. I'm stopped at the entrance by a guard until we're checked. People here are a bit on edge lately thanks to monster attacks. Once the confusion is cleared up, they let us in. Apparently, thanks to the monster attacks, a citizen named Jerin is being held for ransom. For some reason, Lufia blames the other citizens for it. Even the priest is upset that he can't do any more for her. At the armour shop, I buy a brawn robe for 1500 gold and two sets of tan shoes for 840. The brawn robe is 3 points more defence over Lufia's chain cloth, and the tan shoes are 2 points above the cloth shoes. Mixam gets the other pair. I also buy a 1400 gold brawn armour to replace Agaro's chainmail. Had I not looked out on that much stronger light armour, I would have bought one for Mixam too. There's a cave entrance next to the church leading to what I think is supposed to be a warehouse. There are two chests in here holding a float and high potion. In the back room we finally get the rest of the context as to why the town is at fault for Jerin's capture. When they mean ransom, they mean they offered her up to the monsters in exchange for not being attacked again, and will have to pay on top of that if they want her back. One of her friends says that she was chosen to be handed over, but Jerin went in her place. When I tell her friend that I'll rescue her, she tells me that in the cave to the southwest of here is a key to the dais where Jerin's being held. Her brother guards the key, and all I have to do is tell him that his sister told him to get the key. Another girl feels bad for Jerin, but at the same time is glad it wasn't her chosen. Considering the situation and how everyone is fearing for their lives, it's only natural to feel some relief that it won't be you this time. It's not like she's actively celebrating Jerin being taken instead of her. The shelves in the back hold a mind guard and power guard. The largest building in town has people debating on whether or not they can afford to pay for Jerin's return. One old woman says that the dais that Jerin is being held at is through a cave leading to an island to the west, but they locked said cave so no one can save her. The shelves in here contain a revive and a high magic. Now that I know my next destination is a cave to the southwest, what if I went east instead? I cross this bridge and another to the north as I reach a huge desert. I then keep moving east. I'm coming here a bit earlier than I should be, so the enemies are a lot stronger than I'd be used to until now. First up we have orcs and blue wolves. These orcs are strong enough that a single attack can remove a third of Lufia's HP. I guess to make up for her almost death, she reaches level 14 from this fight. Next new enemy in my journey through the desert is the Mudman. They're almost as strong as the orcs, but can also heal other enemies with strong. This time Lufia doesn't survive the fight. Next we have a palette swap of the green orb, the red orb. These have the bad habit of calling for more red orbs to show up, but since these are so easy to kill, it just means more XP for me. At the east end of the desert is another village. This is Surinagal. We're coming here early to buy better equipment slightly earlier than the developers intended. From the weapon shop I buy a 3000 gold axe and a 2400 gold rapier. The axe is 14 points stronger than Mixam's scimitar, and the rapier is 21 points stronger than Lufia's mace. I then buy Agaro his own axe too. Since he was still using a spear, he gets a nice 51 point attack increase. The armour shop next for a bronze shield at 720 gold, 3 points stronger than the wood shield. In the house east of the shops, the shelves have a miracle and high magic. A woman in that house knows that Elfreya is to the south, but I need to pass through the Lost Forest first, which only elves know the way through, which is why I need an elf. An old man says that the island to the north is the Isle of Forfeit, a place where any items I sell find their way, so I never run the risk of permanently losing an item. Considering some decisions like the encounter rate that were a little behind the times, this feature is very ahead of its time for 1993. I don't know of many RPGs from around this time that had something like this. I swap some rings around, Agaro going back to the Dais ring, and Mixam getting the power ring back now that we're not in the Ghost Cave anymore. There's a chest in the weapon shop I can open for a high potion. I also stock up on some powerful big arrows and high arrows. The former do huge damage to a single enemy, while the latter do a little less to a group. Then a load of status healing items, like the new stone cure. I decide to head back to Belgen to continue the plot, but Lufia still has a staying alive problem though. The cost of resurrection from a church is 20 gold multiplied by the dead character's level. On the journey back, Mixam reaches level 15. Back at Belgen and after resting at the inn, I get moving southwest like Jerin's friend told me. Another new enemy in the beetle. There's a split in the land here and we need to stay south. Next new enemy is a mummy. After that fight, I can move southwest uninterrupted to find the southwest cave. To start with, in the first room, all I can do is move southwest and get down some stairs. On the next floor down, I go southwest and through a door to find my first chest. Then down the stairs slightly east of that door. That allows me to go northeast to find two more chests. My first fight in here gets another new enemy, Poison Rat. In every RPG I ever play, it's always the puny little poison rats I'm wary of, more than any huge dragon or the like. They just always tend to be infuriating little bastards. I'm glad I stocked up on so many antidotes. My first fight after going down the first set of stairs gets Agaro to level 14. That first chest is a high potion. Down those stairs and the two chests contain a smoke ball and float. Back to the previous floor, I take the stairs slightly east of the ones I just used. This section of the floor is a one-way winding path with three chests on the way and an item hidden in the poison. I then go back up those stairs to the previous room again and all the way northwest, through a door to more stairs back down. But this time I'm put on the outer wall of the floor, so I just walk south, east and north to more stairs to a new area. First fight down here gets me the new killer bee enemy. These have an attack that paralyzes, so I hit them too. First chest down here is an escape, then the next two are a power potion and spell potion. The item hidden in the poison is a miracle. The rest of the route I mapped out has nothing happen. But as for the fourth floor down, I have all four cardinal directions to inspect. First, there's a scimitar hidden in the poison next to where I enter from. To the north is some stairs to a straightforward northwest corridor with two chests at the end. The chests contain a fly ring and revive. The fly ring lets the wearer deal more damage to flying enemies, but I don't find it worth bothering with. Back up the stairs and next I go west through a door. Two chests in here, high potion and high magic. The next battle gets Lufia to level 15, which teaches her the stronger version of the healing spell strong... stronger. To the east next and through another door. Three more chests in here. Brawn Helm, Brawn Armor, and Brawn Shield. The shield and helm go to aggro. That just leaves the southern route. Down the stairs and through the door it leads to, there's a chest guarded by Jerin's friend's brother. He knows why we're here and moves aside, saying he'll take full responsibility if there's any trouble with the people of Belgen. The chest contains the Dais key. I then leave and make it all the way back to Belgen to heal without anything important happening. Once I've rested and sold off old equipment, I finally put one of my swing wings to use. Mixam is now level 15, so I walk back to Grenoble. This time the man in the shop says to go down to the fourth floor of the old cave and bring back a crown for 2,000 gold. So I head on back down there. Right where I enter there are three chests. I go south a little, then west to grab two more, then south to another. Then it's east for two more chests before I go back west and through a door to nine more chests. From that room I head all the way north, getting another on the way to this door to a room with four more chests. Then I go all the way to the east of this floor, getting three more chests, then north to get another three and an item hidden in the poison. Those first three chests are a smoke ball, high potion and empty. The ones on the west are empty and a magic guard. The one south of them is empty. Then Mixam reaches level 16 and learns Statue, the petrification spell. Moving east, the chests are 520 gold and empty. Then into that southwest room, the chests are empty, Brawn Helm, Longsword, which I give to Agaro for an 11 point increase over the axe, Light Robe, which is 3 points above Lufia's Brawn Robe, empty, a Buckler for 3 more defense than Mixam's Brawn Shield, a Flame Ring, which makes fire spells more powerful, Wind Heals, and Light Armor. Now Agaro can have a set of Light Armor. Moving north, the chest outside the door is empty. Through the door is another empty, a miracle, empty, and empty again. Now heading east, I get a high magic, escape, and long nail. Then north where I float, crown, and broad rod, which I will not be using. You may notice I missed another item hidden in poison in the old cave. I return to Grenoble and hand over that crown for my 2 grand. I then walk back to Belgen. Now to head for the Dais. I get going southwest from Belgen again, but this time when I reach the split in the land, I take the northern half. As I pass through the little gap in the mountains, Agaro reaches level 15. A little further west is the entrance to the cave to the Dais. I start all the way on the east. First I go west to reach a north and south fork. First I go south to find 3 chests. Back to the fork and north through the door, then west and down a ladder, west a little more, and north through another door. Down a ladder in there for another chest and out another door to go west up a ladder and across a bridge for 2 more chests. Backtracking through that north room, I go south down a ladder and southeast down another for 2 more chests, then west across a bridge, past a ladder and north under another bridge for the last 2 chests. Then it's up that ladder I skipped and west across the bridge I just went under. Down a ladder, then northwest up 2 more, then further northwest to reach the stairs leading out of here. Those first 3 chests when I turn south are a Great Potion, Mind Potion and Speed Potion. The Dais key is used to open that first door. Through it is the first new enemy in this place in the Mimic. The chest in the northern room is afloat and the 2 across the bridge are a high magic and a revive. Lufia reaches level 16 on the way to the next chests. The 2 chests down that ladder are a Mind Guard and Power Guard. The last 2 chests are a Spell Potion and Power Potion. Then the rest of the journey through the cave is nothing noteworthy. I end up outside on the other side of the mountain. I get travelling west, facing my first sand rose, a palace up of the Draku Rose. Continuing west and across a bridge to reach the Dais. In front are 2 guards stopping me from going further, but the party can see Jerin behind them. Lufia can't believe that they are doing this to a child, but Agaro points out that she is not a child, she's half-elf. She only looks so young because they age slower. Either way, they can't just leave her like this. Lufia suggests beating up the guards and taking her, but Mixam says that then they'll just do the same to another innocent person. They have to stop the cause for the ransoms in the first place. There's a pair of pots here to recover HP and MP, and a priest so I don't have to go back through the cave whenever I want to save. We go to leave but are surprised by a scream. A monster flies in above Jerin and swoops off with her. The guards say that the monster flew to the North Tower and that maybe I could find Jerrion on the top floor there. Back on the world map, I just get travelling north and the North Tower isn't very far away. This dungeon is one big teleporter maze. To start with, I take the teleporter in front of me to teleport past this fence, then all the way north and up these stairs. On the second floor, I then take the stairs to the southeast to a room with seven chests. When you get to the second floor, you will see tiles of a different colour. These mark which tiles on the third floor are breakable and will drop you back here. Those chests on the third floor are a revive, then I get interrupted by this dungeon's first new enemy, the archer. Then a mystery pin, stone cure, shriek, high potion, a straw man as the next new enemy, an antidote, mix I'm reaching level 17, and an awaken. Then back down to the first floor. I go to the northeast room and take the teleporter there to the northwest room so I can go up the stairs. The second floor is all the way south, east and north to more stairs with a chest on the way. Then on the third floor a series of small rooms with just stairs to climb. The chest has a flash ring which increases the damage dealt with lightning spells. I let Lufia wear it for now. The next battle introduces a skeleton enemy, and just before the stairs up to the third floor is the nightmare. Then up a few sets of stairs to the top floor which is covered in teleporters. First to the teleporter in the centre west to a chest, then the first one to the northeast from that one leading to a few of those raised platforms leading to another chest. Then the centre east teleporter to warp across more raised platforms to reach the end of this dungeon. That first chest is a miracle, as is the second. On the way to the centre east teleporter, Agaro reaches level 16. I then take those last few teleporters to reach the monster that has Jerrion. The monster says that Jerrion will be the key to Amon's revival. Recognising the name of another Sinistral, we start a fight. The follower has 982 HP. I start with Power Gods on Mixam and Agaro and have Lufia cast Drain on the follower, then heal when she needs to. Those buffs and debuffs have Mixam and Agaro's first turn attacking take over a combined fifth of the follower's total HP. However, buffs have one of the worst durations before wearing off I've ever seen in an RPG, and the follower can cast Drain himself too. He also has access to Frost to damage the entire party, and Drowsy to put them to sleep. And he can heal himself for close to 100 HP by casting Stronger. Thankfully, when he does cast Stronger, Mixam and Agaro's combined damage outpaces it, so he's just wasting his turn. At least when Drowsy does land, Lufia is unaffected so she can cast Waken and I don't lose several turns. Apart from what I've already mentioned, he also has a few single target attacks that aren't worth describing. Despite having the most HP of any boss so far, we're pretty much out of early game hell by now, so he may actually be the easiest boss so far too. I'm never in any danger until he's killed. We check on Jerrion, who seems to be fine, and Mixam escorts her back to Belgen. After resting at the inn, the party say their goodbyes to Jerrion, but she wants to come with them instead. The party don't want to risk her life right after they've just saved it. Jerrion at least gives Mixam a miracle as thanks. She asks if she'll ever see the party again, and they both feel confident that they will. But that'll have to wait for next episode, as, like with the Ease videos I just made, the Lufia coverage is also ending up far longer than expected. So I have been complaining a lot about quite a few gameplay elements throughout the video. But despite that, I have been able to enjoy the game past those complaints. However, as I said, the game is at its most frustrating in the beginning, so a lot of my points of complaint can only get more tolerable from now on. I'm still enjoying the simple story, and our amusingly bitchy party is only going to get better in the next episode with the arrival of our fourth and final party member. Along with that, we have finally meeting Arteta to look forward to and exploring the remaining three quarters of the world.